expert webinar presented by Accountants World. Our topic today will be Pricing on Purpose, Creating and Capturing Value, presented by Ron Baker from the VeriSage Institute. I want to thank you for joining us today. My name is Div Bansali. I'm a vice president here at Accountants World. We're delighted to have you with us today for this presentation. Today is actually the final expert webinar in our 2017 series. So we're very excited with the way the entire series has gone. If you have not been to any of the other webinars or if you missed some of them, all of the recordings are available on our expert webinars page. And you can go to accountantsworld.com to be able to view any of those recordings on demand. Before we get started with Ron, just a couple of housekeeping notes here. If you are not familiar with the GoToWebinar tool, or if you haven't used it in a while, you can expand and hide the GoToWebinar control panel using the orange arrow. If you'd like to see your audio options, you can listen in via computer audio or via phone call. Just click on the audio tab and you'll be able to see both of your options there. If you dial in via phone call, it'll provide you with a dial-in number as well as an access code in order to be able to be counted as being on the webinar. If you haven't yet downloaded Ron's handouts for today, his slide deck is available as a PDF under the Handouts tab. I should mention that sometimes when we have many, many people trying to download at the same time, the GoToWebinar tool gets hung up for a little while on downloading. So just please be patient with us if you haven't downloaded yet. And if you're not able to download during the presentation, no worries. We're going to send you a copy of the PDF or a link to the PDF in an email afterwards as well. And finally, if you have any questions for Ron during the presentation, please go ahead and open up the questions tab and you can type in your question there. Ron and I will be looking at the questions that are coming in throughout the presentation. He'll try to answer as many as possible during and otherwise after the presentation as well. We do offer one free CP for participation in today's webinar. And active participation is demonstrated by three things. Number one, attending the live webinar for no less than 50 minutes. Number two, responding to all three poll questions in the webinar today. And number three, there'll be a post-webinar survey. It'll pop up when you close out of your GoToWebinar window at the end of today's webinar. So when you close that out, you should see the pop-up come up with the post-webinar survey. You simply fill that out. If you don't see it, we'll send you an email link to that in our follow-up email as well, so you can fill it in there. CP certificates will be emailed probably by early part of next week after eligibility has been confirmed. If you haven't received it by next Monday or Tuesday, you can email us and let us know. Today's webinar, as well as everything in the 2017 Expert Webinar Series, has been brought to you by Accountants World. And we like to say that Accountants World brings you the full power of the cloud. We've been the recognized pioneer in cloud computing solution designed exclusively for accountants for over 15 years. And our mission is very simple. We feel that technology has been used to take control of core services, including accounting and payroll, away from accountants. And our mission is to put that control back into the hands of professional accountants like you. So we're committed to using cloud technology to develop solutions in client accounting, in bookkeeping, payroll, live payroll, as well as after the fact payroll, document management, practice management, websites, and more. And another thing that differentiates us, you see some of our accolades on the right-hand side there from CPA Practice Advisor, but in addition to our high-quality solutions, we always put accountants first. We never compete with professional accountants by selling to their clients. We only sell to accountants, and so we only profit when our customers are profiting as well. If you'd like to learn more about our solutions or get a free live no obligation demo of our accounting and payroll solutions, you can visit accountantsworld.com or call 888-999-1366 for a live demo. Before I turn it over to Ron Baker, I'd just like to give you a brief bio of him, and we'll also start with one poll question before I turn it over to him. Ron is the founder of the VeriSage Institute. He actually started his CPA career over 30 years ago with KPMG. The Verisage Institute he founded later. It's a leading think tank dedicated to educating accounting professionals worldwide. Ron has delivered his message on value pricing to over 150,000 professionals. And Ron has, for five consecutive years, been recognized as one of Accounting Today's top 10 influencers in the industry. So before we bring Ron on board, I'd like to go ahead and get us started with today's first poll question. So I'll go ahead and launch that. And this is really just so that Ron and I can get a little bit of a better sense of who we have in our attendee audience today. So I've just launched the poll question here. And the poll question very simply is, what is the size of your firm? Are you a sole practitioner? Are you in a 2 to 5 partner firm, 6 to 10 partners, more than 10 partners, or not in public accounting? So if you could please go ahead and fill that out. And just a reminder, this is the first of the three poll questions that we will be asking today. And voting in all three of the poll questions is required in order to get CP. So we'll give about 10 to 15 more seconds here for folks to go ahead and choose their response. Don't forget to click the submit button after you select your response. And I want to welcome some of the folks who've just joined us in the last few seconds here. You are not too late here. You can still go ahead and vote in the poll. You should be seeing that in front of you right now. All right, so we'll give about 5 more seconds here for the stragglers to go ahead and get their vote in. Going once, going twice. Okay, so it looks like we have about 56% sole practitioners or 2 to 5 partner firms, and then some who are larger as well. 13% of you not in public accounting. I think what we're going to learn about today hopefully will be applicable for your purposes as well. So at this time, I would like to go ahead and turn it over to Ron Baker.
All right. Well, thanks, Div, and welcome everybody to Pricing on Purpose, Creating and Capturing Value. I'm just going to start. This will be relevant not only to the firms here, but even if you're not in public accounting, for the 13 or so percent that aren't, this is still relevant to you. And for a very simple reason, everything I'm about to show you is all grounded in economic theory. And what makes economic theory so robust is it deals with human behavior, and it doesn't matter where that behavior takes place. So there's no special law of supply and demand for just accountants or just law firms or any other business. It's applicable to all. That's what makes economics such a powerful discipline. So even if you're not in public accounting, all businesses grapple with pricing, and some of these principles you'll be able to use as well. But specifically for the accountants, let's talk about, this is one of my all-time favorite lines, if we want things to stay as they are, things will have to change. It's from a novel called The Leopard. And I love this line because obviously accounting is a noble industry. We want that to stay the same. We always want to add value as a profession to the public. Indeed, that's what gives us our privileges, as long as we're able to add value outside of ourselves. But we recognize also that if we want that to stay the same, then the way we practice is dramatically changing. And it's driven by the technological factors, you know, not just the cloud, but all the other technologies coming down the pike, artificial intelligence, deep learning, machine learning, blockchain, all of these things have the power to not only disrupt the accounting profession, but to force the economics to be different. What the prior founder of Intel, Andy Grove, called an inflection point, when the basic economics of your industry is changing. And I think that's kind of what is going on here. So when we talk about pricing, we're not just talking about changing the way your firm prices. We are talking about a fundamental business model change. And when a business model changes, two things happen. The way you price changes, and what you measure changes. I cannot find an exception to those two rules throughout commercial history. There's been lots of business model changes, and you can just think of some of the recent ones, whether you're talking about what Napster did to the music industry, and then what iTunes did to it, or now streaming, right? Now, a lot of us pay for streaming music. You can think about what Airbnb is doing to hotels. You can think about what Uber is doing to taxis. I mean, we could go down the list of business model changes. And again, two things fundamentally change with every single business model that I've ever studied. The pricing model changes, and what you measure inside of a business changes. And therefore, value pricing is much more than just changing the way you price. It touches everything inside your firm. Pricing has become a C-suite function in the rest of corporate America and indeed around the world. There are now certified professional pricers. It's a profession. You can get a PhD in pricing. You can get a PhD in revenue management, yield management, it's called. You can get a master's. You can get an MBA from some universities in pricing. So this has become a separate function, a separate discipline, and it's elevated pretty quickly into the C-suite. A lot of pricers in large companies report directly to the CEO. So some of the things that I'm going to be showing you today are already practices that we see in larger corporations. We're just trying to bring some of the same strategies, some of the same thinking down to professional firms, because I think that we're a little bit behind in terms of the way we price. And if you think about our business model, it goes back to this gentleman. His name is Reginald Heber Smith, and he's the father, by the way, of both the billable hour and the timesheet. He was the first person that I can find anywhere in the world who simultaneously introduced both the billable hour and the timesheet. Now, he introduced them into his law firm. He's a Harvard-educated lawyer, and he was greatly influenced by the zeitgeist of the time, which was the Frederick Taylor, the scientific management movement. That was big in this era, and he was greatly influenced by that. Now, if you think about this, the timesheet and the billable hour, we're coming up on its 100th year anniversary. And my question to everybody is, has the world changed? I mean, to think that we're stuck with the same business model that this gentleman introduced over 100 years ago, with all the different changes that have gone on and all the changes that are coming, I think this model is increasingly obsolete. Or to put it a better way, this model is completely suboptimal. It doesn't take account of the things that accounting firms are really leveraging. You're not leveraging time. You're not leveraging people. You're leveraging knowledge and expertise and intellectual capital. And I just don't think we can afford to stick with a business model that's coming up on this 100th year anniversary. So let's dive into pricing. We're going to look at one aspect of the model. Obviously, I can't talk about all the other changes that will take place as a result of your firm changing its pricing. But other things will change too, including what you measure, how you market, how you communicate to your customers. It may even change partner compensation and things like that. Pricing doesn't start with what you're selling. It starts with what the customer is buying. And this kind of forces us to look at the psychology of what customers are really buying. Peter Drucker, who's one of my mentors, he's no longer with us, but he said the customer never buys a product. By definition, the customer buys the satisfaction of a want. He buys value. Right. Nobody goes into a Porsche dealership and maybe test drives the car and, you know, turns around to the salesman and says, oh, what an awesome car. Can I see the timesheets on this? I'd like to know how long it took Porsche to make this car. Or what's the profit margin to Porsche if they sell me this car? We don't buy things that way. Human beings don't buy things that way. And remember that it's all human beings. There's nobody here but us people. Right. Sure. Big companies have professional buyers, but those buyers are human beings. IBM buys nothing. People inside of IBM buy things. And so human beings bring their own prejudices. They bring their own subjective notions of value. They bring their own risk assessments. They bring their own fears into every purchase. In fact, one of the greatest lines ever developed was by IBM customers that nobody ever got fired for buying IBM. What that meant was that yes, we paid a premium price for this, but they're IBM. So if something goes wrong, right, IBM will fix it. Well, that was kind of an insurance policy, right? So humans buy things and humans have different perceptions of value. And that's where, I think that's where we really need to focus, because if you think about the billable hour, if you think about our business model as it's been for the last 100 years, and by the way, law firms started with the billable hour and the timesheet. Accounting firms didn't pick it up until about the 60s and into the 70s. So we lagged behind the lawyers. But our business model, I always explain it this way. It's kind of like when a friend or a loved one has a baby. None of us want to hear about the labor pains. We want to see the baby. But if you think about pricing by the hour, or billing by the hour, not only is it focused on the labor pains, but we're charging the customer for those labor pains in 6-minute contractions. All the while, the customer cares about the baby. So it diverts our attention from focusing on what the customer is really buying. There's not a customer of anybody on this webinar who buys your time. Nobody buys time. You can't buy time. Time is one of those egalitarian things that you can't hoard, you can't store, you can't sell, it just passes. It's not what you're buying when you hire a doctor, a lawyer, an accountant. Even my plumber, I'm not buying his time. I'm buying what they can do for me. I'm buying the outcome that they're providing. And so by focusing on the labor pains, by focusing on the inputs, the efforts, the activities, we're distracted from focusing on what the customer is really paying for, which is the outcome, or what I'm going to call the transformation. So let's get some terms straight. Just to be clear, the reason I continue to use the term value pricing, even though I do not recommend that you use it with your customers, don't say value pricing to your customers, don't market value pricing, say something like fixed price or just price. Right? Don't use the word fee, because fee conjures up, a government tax or something. Nobody likes to pay fees, but price has got a benign, it doesn't conjure up. It's a benign word. It doesn't conjure up any negative or positive feelings. We're all used to saying, what's the price? And when I started to do this in my CPA firm back in 1989, I called it a fixed price agreement, because I wanted to convey certainty to the customer. And just like a fixed rate mortgage is more valuable than a variable rate mortgage. But the reason I continue to use the term value for educational purposes such as this is because value has got a very specific and technical definition in the economics profession. And that is the maximum amount a consumer will pay for an item. Now, that's a useful concept, and we're going to explore that. A couple of other words I just want to make sure that we understand. Billing takes place after your work has been performed. And that's usually why it's called hourly billing, because it takes place after you do the WIP report. You see all the time from everybody that goes into it. You might write it down more times than not before you send the bill. But that's all take place after the work is performed. Pricing, on the other hand, takes place before the work is performed. And there's no exception to this. Everything you buy as a consumer, you know the price before you buy it. I mean, right now, United Airlines has some $20,000 of my money for flights that they haven't flown me yet. Now, how do they do that? Well, two reasons. One, they price in advance. And two, they ask for payment. We could do the same thing if we were able to price in advance. In fact, the thousands of firms that operate with value pricing, a lot of them have what we call pre-ceivables. They've been paid for work that they haven't done yet. And that's not a good thing to have, because then you don't have the bureaucracy and the non-value-added task of billing and collections and financing those accounts receivable lists and all of that. So there's no such thing as value billing. If we hear anybody say, I value bill, I know they don't know what they're talking about, because billing takes place in arrears. Pricing takes place up front. And that's a key distinction, because it's how we buy everything else. So I'm going to share with you today two laws of pricing. And the first law is this: all value is subjective. Now, for we accountants, and I'm a CPA, we like objectivity. We don't like things that are subjective, because then we can't precisely measure them, or there's no formula for it. There's no checklist. But when it comes to value, all value is completely subjective. Now, let me try and prove this to you. I'll just give you one example. I want you to think about a bottled water, right? Now, Coke makes bottled water, Pepsi makes bottled. I mean, we could figure out the cost per bottle, right? That's not rocket surgery. And you can even think about the price that you would pay for that water, right? If you bought it at a Sam's Club or a Costco, you're probably going to pay a lot less than if you bought it, say, in a grocery store or at a 7-Eleven, right? Think about buying it at a hockey game or a sports arena. Think about buying it in a mini bar out of a hotel, right? You know, there's a various range for water. I mean, we pay more for water in this country than we do for gasoline, which is kind of interesting. But I don't want you to think about the cost or the price. For the moment, just think about the value. Because remember, in any transaction, three things are happening. There's the cost, there's the price, and there's the value. And I want you to think about, what is the value of a bottle of water? Well, that's a fascinating question, because if you think about it, the first response is, well, it depends, right? Because if you're in the desert and you haven't had water for 3 or 4 days, I'm going to suggest to you that that bottle of water is worth quite a lot to you, possibly your life, possibly everything you're worth, and then some, right? It's a very high amount if you haven't had water for 4 days. But if you're home washing the dog with the same quantity of water, now what's it worth? Well, it's going to be worth a lot less. What if you're flooded in your basement with water, right? It's going to be have a negative value, because now you got to pay somebody to come out, pump it out. Folks, in all three cases, we didn't change the product. It's H2O in all three of those situations. But the value goes from very high to negative. How does that happen? You know, accounting can't explain that. Cost accounting can't explain that, because accounting and cost accounting, they're not theories. They have no theory. Accounting is just an identity equation. The theory is all value is subjective. That is a testable theory. And over and over and over, it's proven correct, which is why you're willing to pay a range of acceptable prices for a Coke or a bottle of water or your home or other things that you buy. Right? There's not just one price in a market. There's a range of acceptable prices depending on the context. So all value is completely subjective. Another way to think about this is, again, in any transaction, there's three things happening. There's the cost, there's the price, and there's the value. Now, even if you went to Starbucks this morning and spent $4 on a latte, when you walked into Starbucks, you probably didn't say, gee, I hope that Starbucks has figured out the price of this cup of coffee so they make an adequate profit, right? You were probably looking at around, you were gauging and judging the experience. What kind of music are they playing? Are they friendly? Did they get my order right? Did they smile when they delivered? You know, all of those things. We probably make hundreds of judgments just, you know, sitting in a Starbucks. But the fact of the matter is, we don't care about their costs. Right? And the price we pay for that latte, obviously, hopefully for Starbucks, is going to be above the cost of servicing it to you, delivering it to you. And that's their profit. But why did you spend $4 on it this morning? Well, from an economic perspective, we know that it had to be worth more than $4 to you. Otherwise, you wouldn't have bought it. You would have stayed home, ate a cup of coffee, maybe for a dime. Right? And I think it's pretty safe to say that no matter how much you enjoy Starbucks coffee, you don't enjoy it 40 times more than a cup of coffee you could have made at home. So you only bought it because it was worth more than Starbucks was charging. Now, how much more? I don't know if it's $4 and a penny. I don't know if it's $4.25. I don't know if it's $10 because you're hungover from last night, right? It could be anywhere in there. It doesn't matter. I don't want you to get hung up on the accuracy of the numbers. This isn't accounting. This is value. And the fact that you bought it, that you revealed a preference, shows us that you valued it more than the $4 that you paid, which means in the real world, by the way, debits don't equal credits, because that difference between the gray bar and the yellow bar is your profit. That's what you made as a customer from the transaction. And we don't have a good term for this. Economists call it a consumer surplus, but nobody understands what that means. So we just started calling it a customer profit. And with value pricing, it's really, really important to focus on the gray bar. You don't want to focus on the red bar because the customer could care less about that. That's the labor pains. That's the input. You don't want to focus on the yellow bar because the customer wants to lower that. That's what customers do. They want to try and get the best price. Bless them. That's their job. However, all customers and all firm owners, I hope, want to raise the gray bar. We want to maximize value for our customers. We want to give them a healthy profit, right? Because the more profit they make, the more profit we'll make. The more we can raise that gray bar, the easier it is to put up that yellow bar. Now, you can't put the yellow bar all the way up to the gray bar because then there'd be no profit for the customer. There's got to be a distribution, and price is how we distribute that profit. Prices distribute profit. It's a very interesting way to think about it because both sides to a transaction profit. And what I'm suggesting to you from a strategic standpoint is I'd rather have you have a discussion with the customer about something you're both trying to maximize rather than something that the customer's trying to minimize or that the customer doesn't care about. And that's why I like this bar graph, because I think it's an interesting way to illustrate it. Another way to think about it is if you were to plot on a chain, value chain, what cost plus pricing looks like or what hourly billing looks like, it would follow this model. We're going to provide a service to this customer. We're going to track the cost of providing that service. That's why timesheets came into existence. It was a form of cost accounting more than anything. It was not supposed to be a pricing mechanism. And then we're going to take that cost. We're going to mark it up with some desired profit, hence the plus and cost plus. And then we're going to pray that the price is less than the value to the customer. Now, the problem with this chain is the customer's at the end. Right? And yet the sole and ultimate arbiter of value is the customer. The value is not determined by your costs. It's not determined by your efforts. It's not determined by any of those things. It's only determined by value as seen in the eyes of the customer. And as you just saw, that value can change dramatically depending on the context the customer's in. So the thousands of firms that have adopted value pricing around the world, when they go to price a matter, they invert the chain. They start with a discussion with the customer. They try and learn, is the customer in the desert? Are they washing their dog? Or are they in their basement? And they don't say that because we're going to take advantage of them if they're in the desert. That's not the point, because we're trying to build lifelong relationships here. But we have to understand the value to the customer, because what happens if the customer doesn't like your price and value proposition? When would you rather find that out? I rather have you find that out before you do any work rather than finding out after we've done the work. And that's why our profession writes down and writes off more than we write up. That's why realization rates are below 100%, because we're finding out that the customer doesn't like the price after we've done the work. And at that point, there's nothing you can do. So in a value pricing firm, it's the conversation with the customer that determines the value. It's the value that determines the boundary of the price. And then here's the kicker. It's the price that justifies the costs incurred by the firm to provide the service. Notice that the price drives the cost, not the other way around. Now, I'm a former cost accountant. When I first saw this, my head exploded, because it's not what we're taught in cost accounting, but cost accounting's wrong. This is the way the world works, because if the world didn't work this way, if the world worked the way cost plus pricing shows that it works, no business would ever go bankrupt. Because after all, it doesn't take a rocket science to put a price above a cost. Anybody can do that, right? Your 10-year-old can do that. But businesses go bankrupt all the time, or they don't earn a profit all the time. That's because they're not producing anything of value that people want or desire. So I want to help you move from the top to the bottom chain. And in order to do that, I want to give you an 8-step process. Now, we're not going to be able to go through all 8 steps, but I'll just show them to you, and then you can get a feel for how they look overall. There are additional resources that you'd be able to find out there that I'll cite towards the end of the program as well, that explain the 8 steps in more detail. So here they are. We're going to have a value conversation with the customer. We're going to take the knowledge that we glean from that, and then we're going to, and folks, this is critical, we're going to price the customer, not the services. We've got to get over the fact that you're pricing a payroll tax or a tax return or an audit. You're not. You're pricing the customer. You're pricing the customer, not the service, which is why I want you to set up. I'm a big advocate of centralizing pricing inside of your firm and establishing a value council, and maybe even appointing a chief value officer, somebody who's got final say. The best thing you can do with pricing, and one of the earliest wins that you can have, the low-hanging fruit, if you will, is to take pricing away from people who aren't good at it. And most people that price in professional firms, most of the partners, most of the managers are not good at it. And they shouldn't be pricing. If I was a lousy tax person, you wouldn't let me do tax work. You'd put me somewhere where I was strong. It's the same with pricing. We want to have more than one mind price. If you're in a, like 25% of you say you're in a 2 or 5 partner firm, you should not let a partner price their own work. Have each other price each other's work. Always have somebody else price your work. It's the same logic of why actors and authors have agents, right? Actors and authors have agents because the agents can get them a better price, because none of us are good at pricing ourselves. None of us are. That's just human nature. That applies across the board. Your pricers are your agents. They're there to make sure that you're fairly compensated, that value is, you know, fairly distributed between the buyer and the seller, and that you earn a healthy profit for the work that you do for your customer, and they're not going to back down. So pricing the customer is really key to this. And that's really what value pricing is. You're not pricing services, you're pricing the customer. And then you're going to develop and price options. I'm a big advocate that you offer 3 options to every customer. You know, like American Express, a green card, gold card, platinum card. And I'll give you some strategies to help you do that. And then you're going to effectively present those options to the customer. So issues such as, do I start with my cheapest price first, or do I start with my most expensive price? How do I deal with price objections? Those types of issues. And then the option that the customer finally selects is then going to be codified into a fixed price agreement. The resource I'm going to give you has a sample fixed price agreement for accounting firms, so you'll be able to see that. And then you're going to do proper project management on the job, on the engagement. And project management is necessary no matter how you price. So it's really important that you do good project management. And that's true even if you just hourly bill. I think project management is really critical. If there's scope creep, things that you did not anticipate when you fix the price, well, then you're going to utilize change requests and change orders. And then I want, after the matter is over, whoever does the pricing, the CBO, the value council, I want them to conduct a pricing after action review. It's a series of 20 questions that they'll ask themselves. And this is how we develop a core competency in pricing. I want pricing to be a competency in your firm. Just like you have competencies in tax or audit or reviews or certain maybe industries or other areas that you may practice in, those are all core competencies. Well, pricing needs to be a core competency in your firm as well. And you'll notice something interesting about a core competency. If something's a core competency in your firm, that means that not everybody can do it, right? I mean, businesses are built on the division and specialization of labor. Not everybody's good at everything, right? And so we need to turn pricing over to people who are going to be good at it. And this is exactly why it's pricing has been, you know, moved to the C-suite, but it's also a specialized function in the rest of corporate America because it is so important. It is the number one driver of your firm's profitability. Nothing drives profit, like pricing. Nothing. Not rainmaking, not efficiency gains, not cutting costs. The biggest lever you have to drive bottom line profit is your price. That's the biggest lever you have. Profit is the most sensitive to pricing changes. So these are the 8 steps. Obviously, I can't go through all of them in detail in a 1-hour program. So I'm going to give you some of the highlights and give you some strategies on some of the most important ones. The most important step in this process is the value conversation with the customer. So we're moving from what do you need to what are you trying to accomplish? And this is the time for you to play diagnostician. This is not the time for you to demonstrate expertise. It's not the time to offer solutions. It's the time to step back and diagnose, just like a doctor does. You know, the old saying that the patient understands the symptoms, but the doctor understands the cause. That's what's going on here. You're in listening mode. You're in questioning mode. And one of the best questions or best ways I can illustrate this of what I mean is, let's say you're in the market for a landscaper. And I had 3 landscapers that came out. The first guy came out and he kind of walked around the property with his clipboard. And I know what he's doing. He's scoping out the work. He's seeing how big the lawn is and how long it's going to take his crew. He comes to the end. He says, "Ron, no problem. I'm $40 an hour." Well, the first guy's charging me based on inputs, right? He's charging me $40 an hour. It actually raises more questions than it answers, because I wonder if he's going to send out a 7-year-old, right? How long is this going to take? The second guy comes out, does the same thing. He's got the clipboard. He's walking around, comes to the end. He says, "Ron, no problem. I'm $100 a month." Okay, that's a little bit better. He's charging me based on outputs and he's giving me a fixed price. So obviously I prefer him to the first guy. But the third guy comes out, he's got the clipboard too, but he starts talking to me and he says, "So Ron, what do you do for a living?" "Well, I'm a speaker, travel writer, consultant. I travel a lot." He said, "Yeah, I take it you're not Martha Stewart. Don't like yard work." No, don't hate yard work. Actually, it bores me to tears. I don't want to think about my yard." And he goes on, he says, "Well, so tell me, why are you changing landscapers?" "Well, because my landscaper, I have to go out and point out things to him. And that frustrates me. He's here every week. I'm not. I shouldn't have to point to a dead bush or a sprinkler that's not working. He should know these things and just automatically fix them." He said, "Yes, that can be very frustrating. I understand." So he's engaging me in a conversation. He comes to the end and he says, "Ron," he says, "we're going to take care of everything." And he said, "You're not going to have to think about your yard." And then he said this, folks. He said, "You're going to have the best curbside appeal in the neighborhood." Now, here's a guy who communicated value, who understood what I was buying, understood that I was frustrated with my current landscaper because he made me think about the yard. And then he added the kicker that I'm going to have the best curbside appeal in the neighborhood. He said, "I'm $250 a month." Well, folks, who am I going to hire? He's not charging me based on inputs or outputs. He's pricing me based on the outcomes, or what I'm going to call the transformation. And that's a much more effective way to communicate value. And that's incredibly valuable. He's charging me 2.5 times more than the other bid. And I'm happier paying it because he's making me a satisfied customer. And the thing is, if he goes next door to my neighbor and has the same conversation, my neighbor's going to have a totally different value proposition, because my neighbor loves yard work and he's probably hiring the landscaper for some other reason or some specific thing. And that's going to be a totally, totally, totally different value proposition, because customers are like eyeglass prescriptions. They're all completely unique. And therefore, you're leaving money on the table if you're not pricing the customer and only pricing the service or the scope of work. So what I'm really talking about here is, and this is from a great book, but if you think about the progression of economic value, you know, if you charge for stuff, you're in the commodity business, think agrarian economy, right? Pulling wheat out of the ground. But if you charge for tangible things, then you're in the good business. So you take wheat and flour, mix them, now you got bread. But if you're in the service business, you know, you charge for the activities you execute. And I would dare say most accountants think they're here. However, if you take that service and add an experience and charge for the time customers spend with you, and I'm not talking about billable hours, I'm talking like paying to get into Disneyland, then you're in the experience business, which is memorable. However, if you charge for the outcome the customer achieves, then you're in the transformation business. And I think CPAs are already poised at this level in the transformation economy. We provide transformations to our customers all the time. You help them retire sooner. You give them peace of mind. You help their kid get into college. You plan their estate if you do estate planning. You make their businesses more valuable so they can retire sooner, or maybe buy a dream second home or first home, whatever it might be. These are all transformations. And when you're providing transformations, the customer is the product. And I believe we need to even adopt that type of language, just like this landscaper did by saying to me, you're going to have the best curbside appeal in the neighborhood. That's a transformation. Now, yes, it's a transformation on my yard, but it's a transformation and a reflection on me as a homeowner. And it's much more valuable to me than if he would just sat there and bored me and told me, you know, how long is it going to take to mow the lawn and do the edging and the bush trimming and all that. I mean, I don't care. Those are all the labor pains. I want the baby, and the baby is the best curbside appeal in the neighborhood. All of your customers have the equivalent of the best curbside appeal in the neighborhood. It's your job to figure out what that is. And you're only going to do that if you have the value conversation. So, you know, the old joke that how many times have you seen a CPA tattooed on somebody, right? Somebody tattoos your firm's logo on you. That means you've changed their life. This is why Harley Davidson riders have that tattoo on them sometimes, because that's a transformation, right? When somebody tattoos your firm's logo on their body, then you've transformed that person. This is a black swan tattoo. I don't have time to explain it, but so let me give you the best opening conversation question for the value conversation. Mr. or Mrs. Customer, we will only undertake this engagement if we can agree to our mutual satisfaction that the value we are creating is greater than the price we're charging you. Is that acceptable? That's a great question, because it sets both parties on a quest to uncover value. Now you're going to be looking not at price, not at efforts, not at scope of work, but scope of value. What's the impact from what we're doing? And folks, here's the tricky thing about value. And again, we accountants, we don't like this. Remember I said all value is subjective. Value is not a number. It's a feeling. If you have an Apple product sitting in front of you, my question would be, why'd you pay such a premium price for that? Apple has lots of competitors that sell things for a lot cheaper. You can buy cheaper computers, tablets, phones, other types of devices for a lot less than you pay for an Apple. But yet many of us buy Apple. And if you really dig behind the psychological reasons, they're all feelings. They have nothing to do with ROI or comparing cost and benefit. They're all feelings. Well, I like it. It's beautifully designed, or it's easier to use, or whatever it might be. But those are all feelings. So you have to get into the psychological aspects of your customer, which is why we want you to price the customer. And this leads to something very interesting, which is offering options, which is the third step. So I want you to think American Express, the green card, the gold card, the platinum card. Have you ever wondered why every business, almost every single business, offers us options? You can fly first class, business class, coach. You can get a, you know, junior suite, presidential suite, a regular room, a small, medium, large, tall, grande, vente. I mean, why? Because there's a lot of behavioral economics that backs up giving choices to buyers. We humans like choice. We like choice. Now, we don't like to be overwhelmed with choice, and I wouldn't want you to go beyond three choices, at least not to start with. Some firms are using four, but they're advanced. When you start out with this, you got to give three choices. One of the reasons is because of these questions. I don't have to go through all of these. They're pretty self-evident. But what this is a Dutch economist, Peter van Westendorp, and he's got his price sensitivity meter. What he proved was there's a range of acceptable prices people are willing to pay. There's a range, just like we saw with the bottled water or the or a can of Coke, right? Think of what you pay for a can of Coke. It can vary dramatically depending on where you buy it, meaning there's not one optimal price for a customer. What you have to do with value pricing is you have to think of yourself and your firm as a price searcher, not a price taker. You're not a price taker. In other words, people say, well, this is a commodity service and you know, you can only get so much for payroll or tax return, whatever it might be. But that's not true. That is emphatically not true. You're a price searcher. Customers are willing to pay for within a range of acceptable prices if they see the value. They have to see the value. And that's why the communication and the value conversation, just like that landscaper did with me, is so important. He tuned in right away to what I was purchasing, what the real value driver was. I didn't tell him a number. I told him that I didn't want to think about my yard. And then he came back with, you're not going to have to think about your yard, and I'm going to give you the best curbside appeal in the neighborhood. Now, that was instantly valuable to me. And therefore, he charges a price that's 2.5 times the nearest other bid I got. So, remember, I'm gladly paying it, and I'm more thrilled than I ever have been when I was paying 1/3 that price because I wasn't happy with the other provider. So value pricing makes customers happier. It actually strengthens the relationship because you're adding more value to them and they understand it. So this leads us to the second law of pricing, which is all prices are contextual. And Dave, I know you want to do a poll at this point. So
I do. Let's go ahead and do that. So I'll go ahead and jump in with a poll question. First, Ron, while I'm pulling that poll question up for everybody, one question that came in was, since I'm a one-man office, I struggle pricing my own work. Any suggestions since I do not have a value counsel?
If you're a one-person firm, I would say have your spouse or significant other do your pricing or at least help with your pricing. Your spouse is going to be more bold and brave as a lying pricing you than you are yourself. We all need help with pricing. You should never price your own work. You should never price in a vacuum. Always bounce it off somebody, a coach, a mentor. Maybe one of your customers is a business person that you admire. Find somebody who you can help with your pricing, not a competitor. That's borderline illegal, but find somebody who you trust. They don't have to be an expert, folks. It's a big myth assuming that you have to be an expert and understand the details of what it is somebody does for you to price that work. You do not. I price legal services all the time. I price advertising agency work all the time. And I don't work in those arenas. I'm not a lawyer. So pricing is a general competence that can be applied anywhere because it's multidisciplinary. So I hope that helps. I do see some other questions up here, Div, and I didn't, not sure we're gonna have time to get to them, but I'm happy to start taking them.
Sure, and I'll just give a quick reminder to attendees. The poll question is open in front of you, the second poll question. So if you have not answered that poll question yet, please go ahead and do so. We have 4 choices. Select one of those options and then click the submit button to make sure that your vote gets counted. I see about 85%, a little more than 85% of people have now voted. So we'll give a few more seconds here for folks who have not yet done so. Let's see here if we can pull up one more. Can you price a service when you don't know the time that it will take to provide that service?
Yes, of course you can, because the time you take has nothing to do with the value to the customer or the price the customer is willing to pay, right? My guess is, Greg, you kind of know approximately what a service is going to take, right? You don't have to know it down to the 6-minute increment. You don't have to be that accurate because it's really not driving your costs anyway, right? If you've got a CPA on salary that you're paying, whether they spend 10 hours on something or 20, it doesn't change your cash costs by one nickel, right? We need to model cash, not do cost accounting. That's the big flaw with timesheets. But when you're pricing, the only thing that the amount of time it takes tells you possibly is a minimum price that you should never, ever go below. It does not tell you what the maximum price is to the customers willing to pay. I know Joseph asked about how to present the options. Yes, always present your highest one first. Joseph, that's a great question. But yes, and then Lacey says, there's an upper limit on what people pay for accounting services. I partially implemented value pricing and experienced scope creep with all clients on pricing this way. Well, look, yes, there is an upper bound on certainly on what people will pay. However, you have some control over that. If you're adding more value, if you're providing possibly some other value-added services, whether it's cash flow, budgeting, or a whole host of other things that we could be doing as accountants, you can get that value bar up. You can also get your price up. This is what I mean by you have to think like a price searcher. That's why you give three options, because even if they don't buy your top option, they understand that you could do those additional services and you might buy those options. You know, they might buy them next year, right? So that you got to think like a price searcher.
So I'm going to go ahead and close out the poll here. So 5 last seconds for anyone who has not yet voted, going once, going twice, and we're in. Okay, so Ron, in the interest of time, I'm going to let you go ahead and get back to a few more of your slides here. Okay. So let me go and close that out.
And let me just dive in and you know, talk about options real quick. My bet is, folks, that where you get your car washed, you see something like this. So why is it that car wash establishments are more sophisticated than accounting firms? Now, if you're not offering options, you're missing a very powerful pricing psychology and behavioral economic effects. Dan Ariely has written extensively on this, especially in his first two books. He's a behavioral economist. He gave an example of The Economist running an ad for a one-year subscription of its publication. Here are the three options. When he looked at this, he said, well, look, nobody bought the print-only option, so let's take that off. And he reran the ad. When he reran the ad, look what happened to the market share. They flipped. Because most people, when you put three options in front of them, they'll make a value decision. When you put two options in front of them, they'll make a price decision. More times than not, they'll pick the cheapest of the two prices. But this is why, if you offer options, you have to do three. Don't do four, don't do two, do three. It's called Goldilocks pricing. It's so powerful, which is why you see it everywhere. This increased, by the way, the revenue to The Economist by 43%, which is dramatic. I mean, the cost of running these ads were the same, but yet the profit impact to the magazine was substantially different. And the reason is you always want to anchor with your highest price, right? Pravda will have a $22,000 handbag in their store that they don't sell. Why is it there? Because it makes the $2,000 or $3,000 handbag look more affordable and more people will buy that. It's known as the anchoring effect. Your first price should be your highest, superior, best offering. Even if the customer doesn't buy it, most of the times it will nudge them into buying the middle option. The second effect that you're seeing with offering three options is framing. Red Bull put itself in a tall, skinny can, so our brains would say, oh, energy drink, sure, that's worth $2. If they'd put themselves in a Coke or Pepsi size can, you would have said, oh, well, that's a soft drink. So what you're compared with, this is what we mean by all prices are contextual. What a customer compares you to often determines what they're willing to pay for something, right? If I said, would you like to buy my unicorn? You wouldn't know what to pay because you've never bought one before. So what is the customer comparing you? Now, sometimes that's what your competitors are charging. But are you going to try and make an argument that what your competitors charge is the maximum you can charge? Because folks, if that's true, Apple wouldn't exist. Disney wouldn't exist, right? Gore-Tex, L.L. Bean, Nordstrom, none of these high price, you know, outfits would exist. If the competition determined the total maximum you could charge, I don't buy that. There's ways to charge premium prices, deliver a great experience, have great customer service, be accessible, bundle in unlimited access. I mean, there's lots of things you can do. the way you can create choices is you can notice that we're not differentiating these choices based on technical quality of work. We're differentiating the choices based on service, right? Your technical quality is a given, right? Just like an airline has to land safely for all the passengers, whether they're in first class or coach, you have to provide technically competent work. However, what you can differentiate on is service. So you can change things like timing. How fast do they want their stuff? If they need it tomorrow, that should be a different price than if they can wait 6 months, right? So timing can almost always be used to differentiate three options. Payment terms. Payment terms are just another form of price. So you can tweak the payment terms. Your cheapest priced option, you should ask for 100% upfront. Middle price option, maybe you give them payment terms for 3 or 4 months. Top priced option, maybe you give them payment terms for 1 year. And you can structure those payment terms, by the way, around their cash flow, not your workflow, which business owners really like, because all business owners have cyclical cash flow cycles. And who understands that better than their accountant? What type of technology are you going to use? Are you going to put them in the cloud? Are you going to convert them to the cloud? Are you going to use various apps? All of these things can be used to create different packages. Talent. Who are they going to have access to in your firm? They're going to be able to access the owner or just maybe the managers. Tailoring. How are you going to tailor the delivery of your knowledge to your customer? Is it going to be all done remotely? Is it going to be over the phone? Is it going to be in person? Are you going to present to their board? How often? All of those issues. And transference basically means education. If you offer webinars or seminars, other programs, you can make that part of your bundle. These are all ways that you can create options. Let me just give you one example here. This is from a bookkeeping firm up in Canada. And now this was one of her first ones, so she got this wrong. She should have put the most expensive package on the far left, going back to one of our prior questions about should you start with your most expensive. Yes, you should. And she's since made that change. But this just gives you an idea and lets the customer look at it and say, okay, these are three different packages. Notice that they're outcomes. They're based on outcomes, not just necessarily the scope of work. She's providing more services in the top package than she is in the middle and in the bottom. There may be more work that the customer has to do with your cheapest price package. Those are all different ways that you can bundle in and create three options. The other thing is, I'm a big believer that you offer a value guarantee on all your work, something similar to this wording. The customer's not happy, they only pay for the value that they received. Now, this scares the heck out of a lot of accountants, but here's my argument. I think you already do this. I think all of you offer a guarantee already, because if anyone in your customers complained, what would you do? You'd make it right. You'd say, pay what you think is fair or whatever, right? So you already have this policy. It's just covert. I want you to make it overt, tell the world about it, get some marketing muscle, get a point of differentiation, and get a price premium for it. If you think of world-class companies, Disney, Nordstrom, Gore-Tex, L.L. Bean, I mean, I could prattle off, you know, FedEx. They have world-class guarantees, world-class, and they all command a premium price because of it. A service that's guaranteed is worth more than a service that's not. It's a very intangible thing, but it's a very real thing to a customer. My veterinarian has a guarantee, not that he's going to keep my dog alive forever, but that I'm going to be happy interfacing with his office. And I promise you, he's not the cheapest vet in town. And then the change orders, if there's scope creep, you use change orders. And those are, you know, this is a great picture. It's a real contractor's boat. The boat's name is Change Order, and the little dinghy is called Original Contract. I think that's pretty clever. Obviously, contractors make their money on change orders, and we shouldn't be afraid of change orders. We should use them for things that were unforeseen, and they're a communication tool. Just like a mechanic would never do unauthorized work on your car, that's why we want to have a change order policy, because we never want to surprise the customer with an invoice from our firm. Folks, these are additional resources you can get from the journalofaccountancy.com, the AICPA's flagship monthly publication. You don't have to be a member. You don't have to register. I've written two articles. You can get them free online. The first one from June, it has got the 8 steps in detail. It's got a sample fixed price agreement. It's got a sample change order. It's got exhibits. There's something like 12 exhibits that detail other of the steps, like questions you can ask the customer, questions you should ask yourself before setting a price, help with developing the 3 options, all of those things. I'm also going to highly recommend my colleague Ed Kless's article in Journal of Accountancy on project management for accountants, which is just absolutely excellent. And I know I'm up against the time here. I'll just leave you with a couple more thoughts. Pricing is an art, but it's also a skill. And it requires wisdom, judgment, and patience. There's no formula. There's no checklist. You're going to have a value conversation with your customer, understand what their value drivers are, customize a price. It'll never be perfect, folks. You're going to make mistakes, but you're making a ton of mistakes now at the billable hour. And at least under value pricing, when you make mistakes, you'll learn from them. Always remember that you will never be paid more than you think you're worth. I mean, after all, if you don't think you're worth a premium price, how are your customers ever going to believe it? So this is why I'm a big advocate of letting other people do your pricing or turn it over to a value counsel. If your firm is big enough, people who are going to study pricing, understand the psychology of it. It is a discipline. It is a profession. We need to up our game with pricing because it's not just going to happen by magic. It requires study. This is how you can get a hold of me. I'm all over the place. I'm on LinkedIn, Twitter. Go to verisage.com. We have tons of resources up there, including frequently asked questions, trailblazer case studies. You can read about other firms that have made this change. I run a radio program every Friday live called The Soul of Enterprise. You can see all of our 170 some odd shows at thesoulofenterprise.com. We talk about these issues much more. I've got books out there. There's my email. Happy to continue the conversation, take any questions I wasn't able to answer today. Thanks so much, folks. And Div, I'll turn it back to you.
That's great. Well, Ron, thank you very much for your time today. I know a couple of folks have additional questions, but I'll go ahead and put up the third poll question here. I know some folks are up against the top of the hour here. So third poll question is up in front of you at this point. And then I've got one closing slide. Ron, one of the questions that came in, how often should pricing be reviewed with the customer?
At least once a year, because, you know, our customers are not snapshots. They're videos, right? They're constantly growing, changing, learning, expanding, contracting. I mean, you've got to have a value conversation at least once a year and then plan for the upcoming year services. And this is one big advantage that we CPAs have over lawyers or other types of professionals. We have that evergreen revenue. We know that they're going to need certain compliance things every year. Those are needs, but what do they want? What are they trying to achieve in the upcoming year? Do they want to expand? Do they want to get an SBA loan? Are they going to have a kid and need college planning? Whatever it might be. Try and anticipate other services that you can add in the upcoming year. And so I think it needs to be reviewed at the least annually, if not quarterly, for some of your bigger customers.
Great. And then one other question from Kimberly. If you could talk about the transition, if you've billed by hour in the past, how do you acclimatize clients to value pricing, especially if their fees might increase?
When you're transitioning, you know, obviously you put all new customers on this. That's a no-brainer because that's really easy and it's a point of differentiation. For your current customers, there's going to be a little bit of education. I would suggest you do it one at a time. I'm not suggesting you cannonball into the pool and do this all at once. Do it one customer at a time. Move at a pace that's comfortable to you. Explain it to them why you're doing it. You want to give them certainty in price. Bundle in things like the guarantee, unlimited access. They can call, meet with you anytime, anywhere. Make that part of your pricing. And if you're going to continue just doing the same services, maybe you can knock it up 5 or 10%, but try and put some other services in that bottom price. So maybe you can knock it up 10, 15, 20%. Find other services you can build into the middle and top prices. And even if they don't buy them, then at least you've knocked the price up. Because what I find in a lot of firms is they're giving, you know, first class service, but they're charging a coach price. And I think that's a big mistake. The prices are probably going to have to go up on the current customers.
That's great. Ron, thank you again for your time today. If anybody has any final questions, you can go ahead and submit those. Just wanted to thank all of you for attending today. Thank all of the attendees. A couple of final things for you. Make sure to fill out the post-webinar survey to receive your CP credit. To do that, when you close out of GoToWebinar, you will see that survey pop up. If you don't see it, we'll email it to you within the next day or so. Also, we have payroll relief webinars about our payroll solution every week, including next week, right before the holidays. So if you'd like to learn how to transform your payroll practice before we get to the new year, this is the perfect time of year to do that. We have some exclusive offers for webinar attendees as well, which we can explain by phone. But the best thing to do is go to payrollrelief.com and you can sign up for the upcoming webinar, see our video as well, and get started. Ron, let me see here if there is any final question we can take here. Should the fixed price for the same service vary by customer, i.e. pricing to the customer?
Yep, absolutely. This isn't a menu price. I'm not suggesting you take those three options and post them on your website and offer them to all the customers. I mean, that McDonald's uses menu pricing. Value pricing is when you're pricing the customer. So your three options and your three prices are customized for every single customer, which means they could be different. And people get nervous about that and they say, well, what if you're offering the same services to two different customers at radically different prices? Well, first off, no two customers are alike anyway, right? Just like me and my neighbor had different value propositions for a landscaper, no two customers that I can think of are exactly alike. We should be able to justify different prices. And by the way, confidentiality, you can't talk about what other customers pay you, right? So I wouldn't let that worry you, but yes, you are customizing the price for every single customer. That's what we mean by price the customer.
And we'll go ahead and close with one final, hopefully simple question. Kimberly says, I need to revamp my practice. I'm ready to start value pricing. Which book do you recommend I read first?
The orange and purple one, Kimberly, the Implementing Value Pricing. That's my latest and greatest. It's everything nuts to bolts that you need to make this transition. But you can start with the cliff notes on that book, which is the Journal of Accountancy article that you can find from that slide that I showed you. And that's got a sample fixed price agreement, and that will help you with the 8 steps. But to really go in depth, the Implementing Value Pricing book, the orange and purple one, is the one to get. You can get it on Kindle, Amazon. It's all over the place.
Okay, sounds great. Ron, thank you so much for your time today. We here at Accounts World really appreciate it. I know the attendees do as well. Thanks to all the attendees who came today. If we don't speak to you before then, please have a great holiday season, and we'll look forward to communicating with you more in the weeks ahead.
Great. Thanks, Dave, and thanks, everyone.